So I realized afterwards that the key part of my talk title, Stingray, that the name of the package wasn't actually on the program. So as Perry said, I'm Abby, and I'm going to talk to you about a new package that we are developing called Stingray that is for time series methods of astronomical X-ray data that aren't fishy at all. And on Twitter, I'm Abigail Stev and GitHub. So first, I know that the X-ray binary community is very, very small, and there are not many of us here at all. So X-ray binaries, they're very interesting. They are laboratories for extreme physics, but we cannot spatially resolve them. So we need to turn to other methods in order to figure out what is happening in these innermost, interesting, complex regions. And so the X-rays that we get from here vary on timescales from tens of microseconds to months or years. And the timescales on which they vary and how they vary can tell you something about what is happening on those physical scales. So some of the phenomena that we see include X-ray pulsations. There's a whole zoology of quasi-periodic oscillations. There's broadband peaked noise and probably some other stuff. And there is similar phenomena in gamma, optical, and infrared. So you may have heard of this in your own wavelength. So the way that we study X-ray binaries, we have two dominant ways we do this, is with spectroscopy and with timing. So with spectroscopy, the picture on the far right, we have some energy spectra, and we can fit different models to it to try to figure out what's happening. We have timing down here, where you have a power spectrum. So this is showing you the frequency at which you're seeing variability. And you can try to fit things to it and infer something from the frequencies at which you see variability. And then we've been developing new methods of doing spectral timing, so having fast time resolution spectroscopy, where you can have, for example, energy spectra along one axis and time along another axis. And on the horizon, I wanted to include polarimetry. There is the prospect of having an X-ray polarimeter launched in the next 5 to 10 years, and this is very, very exciting. So hopefully we'll get to add a third leg to this analysis diagram. So when we do variability and analysis, we start off in the time domain. In X-rays, for time data, we get just an event list. So you get a photon arrival time, you have the energy channel, and the detector it was detected in. You just get this huge long list of all your photons, because we count our photons. And we use the Fourier transform, and we can analyze these things in the frequency domain. And so a lot of our analysis is Fourier analysis that we do. And we do this because X-ray variability is very difficult to see by eye. So here's kind of the example I like to show. We have two different light curves from two different sources, and by eye, they look very similar. However, if you make the power spectrum, you take segments of these and average them together, their power spectra, then you can see that the power spectra are very, very different, and there are different overall trends in the source data. So this is why we like to use Fourier techniques. So we had a workshop on spectral timing of X-ray binaries in AGN in February at the Lorentz Center in the Netherlands. And we asked them, which analysis methods do you want to have available to you for some of the new missions that are coming up and for analyzing archival data? And basically, people said all of them. They want all of the methods. They want to be able to do power spectra, periodograms, fitting profiles to these things, signal detection, dynamical power spectra. They want to be able to do cross and co-spectra, cross correlation functions, average and frequency resolved energy spectra, energy or frequency dependent time lags, RMS and covariance spectra, coherence, bispectra, bicoherence, dead time composite. They want everything. And there is no coherent package that offers all of these things in an easy to use way. So the reason why we want to make Stingray is because X-ray timing and spectral timing is relatively a very small subfield of astronomy. So it's not a large community that we have to support. And almost everyone uses variations on the same analysis techniques. So many of the techniques that I just mentioned, they're just kind of tweaks on themselves. So once you can figure out one, the rest aren't so much. However, most of the code that is used in the fields of X-ray timing and spectral timing is private, it is not documented, it is not properly tested, it's not maintained. So if you're lucky, you'll get a tarball from the previous graduate student that has something in it, and hopefully it compiles. And you kind of work from there. So it's mostly black box codes, which is not good for students learning the analysis methods because it's not easy for them to kind of tease through and figure out what's actually happening, like how do Fourier techniques work. It's also not good for streamlining codes and porting it over to other machines because you'll have compatibility issues, etc. We want something that is more coherent that anyone can use effectively. So there's a lot of unnecessary duplication of efforts because Fourier transforms are the same thing on anyone's computer. You don't have to make a different Fourier transform for different computers. Luckily. So because of this, there's a pretty high threshold for entering the subfield because most people have to write their own software before they can start doing data analysis. And that's a year or two that's just kind of used on software development that's not necessarily needed for software development. And also this means it's really difficult to get new students started. It's difficult sometimes to get bachelor's and master's students started as well. If you want to do a small, a short-term project with them, they'll just either use a black box code or have to write their own. So it's not well set up for having a field that's easily accessible. So then the reason why we wanted to make this package was to have easier implementation of, for example, Bayesian methods and machine learning that's specific to X-ray spectral timing that don't really exist in the languages that people are currently using, and don't easily interface or plug into the codes that people want. And many of the analysis methods that we use are already used in finance, music analysis, healthcare, neuroscience, and just general signal processing. So the code exists, and a lot of it exists in Python. And so we want to find ways to apply those techniques to our spectral timing data and just have an easy interface there so you don't have to actually write the code all over again. And our goal for this package is to become an AstroPi affiliate. So this idea of stingrays developed in, I think, September when Daniela emailed me before Astro Hack Week and said, "Hey, do you want to work on this like Python timing package?" I said, "Yeah, that's a great idea," because we both have our own code that we have developed that we thought, well, we should put this together in a consistent format and make it public so people can easily use it. And so when I proposed to give this talk back when I applied in October, Stingray had a logo and a README.
And a license.
And a license, and a license. And so we are a baby package compared to what everyone else has been talking about. We have, but we do have some modules that are in the master branch, very exciting. We have a light curve module, so I made some here data. The black is big energy band, and then the other two are smaller energy bands. We have a power spectrum class that is in black here. The cross spectrum is actually in one of my branches. I haven't pushed it to master yet, but that's in the pink here. So you can begin to do co-spectral and cross-spectral analysis. There are also a bunch of pulsar tools that Matteo Bacchetti has pushed from his MultPint package. So we're kind of implementing a lot of the code that individuals of us have in Python. We're putting them into this format that'll work together and then packaging it all up as Stingray. We are using Travis for continuous integration, which has been a learning curve for all of us, but we're glad to be doing it because it'll make the code much more robust in the long run. So I just put this together today, our progress on Git. Ignore the numbers, but you can kind of see like it started here and it's kind of been like Daniela pushed her big classes that she had for her stuff, and then we realized like, oh, we're going to Pi after, we should put some more code on there. But we had 26 forks, and that is a lot of forks for having talked about this once. So we are very, very excited about this. And the other big thing is we have a lot of support from the community in this. So ESA has financial support and two people that are tasked with making a GUI for exploratory data analysis. And when we spoke with them in February at the Spectral Timing Workshop, they were really excited about Stingray and want to make that a part of what they are doing. And so we have actual money and like a real software developer to back this up, which is very exciting. We are part of the Google Summer of Code. That is through ESA, but we might be able to get someone to work on the libraries themselves for Stingray. We likely have support from HiaSARC for developing data structures and input-output interfacing with existing and future missions, because there are going to be some X-ray missions coming up in the future, and we want to know what data formats are those going to be and how can we most easily use them with Stingray. We have the potential for interfacing with SHERPA spectral fitting package, especially for cross-spectral models, because typically most of the models we have now are just energy spectra, so time averaged, and so cross-spectral models are the next dimension for that. And also one of the things that we wanted to bring to you guys here is that you can help. We will eventually want to extend this to infrared and optical fast variability timing and spectral timing. And that is not necessarily expertise that we have. Those are not wavelengths that we're familiar with. And so we need expertise and input from you guys on how we can also serve your needs with this. So for Stingray development, this is our GitHub repo. It's also in the Google Doc link that I tweeted. The project coordinators are Matteo Bacchetti, Paul Baum, Daniela Huppenkotin, Simone Migliari, and myself. Matteo is at Sardinia, I believe, and he's someone who works a lot on Newstar. Paul and Simone are at ESA, and then there's myself and Daniela. Daniela was the initial force behind a lot of this, and we have some GitHub contributors, some of whom I've never spoken to in real life. So this is very exciting. First baby steps for getting an actual package off the ground. And please talk with Daniela about working on Stingray for a sprint or a project during PyAstro, because there's some pretty cool stuff that we would like to see happen. We currently have a lot of code in pull requests, and what we're trying to do now is go through and look at them and be sure that it's all kosher before you merge them. So I think there's a lot of potential for stuff that's going to be happening. And the final thing that's very exciting that was brought to my attention by my supervisor is that technically Stingray has a theme song. So Brits of a certain age will be aware, and I hope that the speakers work.
Where's the volume?
That's it. It's as loud as it goes.
Anything can happen in the next half hour.
I'd be happy to take it.
Want to applaud again? First questions? So what do you think are the main differences in terms of what you have currently and what you're planning, and then what would be needed for infrared and optical and things like that? I mean, do they know relatively applicable? Is it to do the data format?
Predominantly with reading in data. So we're accustomed to count rates, and in other wave bands, you have so many photons that you don't count them, you have fluxes. And so it's very simple things like that, but it's not an immediate integration. I've worked a bit with fast infrared data already, and it just takes a couple tweaks. But one of the other things is that we don't know if there are big caveats that we should be aware of that we just don't know about. So it's just connecting with those communities is, I think, something we could get a lot out of this week. But I don't think it'll be a huge stretch.
Maybe I can just quickly comment. We're trying to build this really modular. So we're building this predominantly for X-ray data, but whenever we built classes, we try to build them in a way that they're easily extensible to other wavelengths. Trying to make this as easy as possible.
So you guys were involved in this planning workshop at Light. My wife was also there and had a.
Oh yes.
So she.
We
was
talked with her about Sherpa,
yeah. With Sherpa and so forth. But the question I have is, did you come away, I mean, that sort of pulled together a lot of the experts in the world in timing, and did you come away with an understanding that there was going to be a buy-in in what you're doing from sort of senior people that have been doing this for 20 years, and be sort of an understanding of the requirements of where you need to go from, you know, starting from the simple things, but a bigger picture of where you need to take this in order to make it really something that a large community can use?
I did get the impression that this is something they're really excited about and that they want to be a part of. And I think it's fair to say that at the beginning of the week, some people were a bit more skeptical. And by the end of the week, they really saw the value and the importance of having something that has a strong projected future that is open source and easily customizable and these kinds of things. So I think we do have quite good support at fairly high levels from senior people about this.
Do you do any comparisons of results with their codes, even if they're not? Can you even run their codes if they're privately held, or they?
I've done comparison with my own codes, and that works out so far. But I think one of the things we could do is we could ask people for their private codes, or even ask them to install Stingray, run it, and then compare with that.
Because that helps build confidence.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Any more questions? Okay, let's thank the speaker again. Do you have any announcements?